Hello friends, myself Dr. Amit Ahuja, Assistant Professor from University School of Education, Guru Gobind Singh Indraprastha University, Delhi. Today, we will discuss characteristic features of EVS, that is Environmental Studies. First of all, what does the term environment mean? Is it a forest? Is it a group of trees? Or it comprises the immediate surroundings? Or simply the world around us? There may be n number of responses to this question, but the thing is, environment means the world around us, starting right from immediate next to me up to the point where the universe ends. So everything is environment. Then from where the term environment has been derived? Actually, it was derived from a French word environner, and that means encircle or surround, that is immediately next to the person. But in a broad sense, the term environment means the whole world that surrounds us. So you can think upon what the term environment comprises. You will appreciate that nothing is left beyond environment. So everything around us that surrounds us is environment. The world around us is not so simple. It comprises natural environment and socio-cultural environment. The natural environment comprises biotic and abiotic components. Biotic component means humans, animals, microorganisms. Abiotic component means water, air, soil, rocks, mountains, etc. They together comprise the natural environment. The socio-cultural environment comprises the family, society, neighborhood, community, etc. The rituals, the traditions, norms, values that are practices prevalent in that society actually constitute the socio-cultural environment of that area. Then, what is the nature of environment? Environment is not a simple entity. It's a whole. It cannot be divided into watertight compartments, or it cannot be divided into segments. It's a whole. It's dynamic. It's never at rest. Another thing is, it is continuous. That is, it's not discrete. And another thing is, it is indivisible. Again, more or less similar to the fact that it is whole, that it cannot be divided. It cannot be cut into different pieces. But it exists as a whole in which all the parts or the units work. The examples of environment include, now in a further sense, it may be natural, artificial, and socio-cultural. The natural environment means the environment or the surroundings that were made by nature. That is mountains, rivers, forest, sea, land are natural in nature. Artificial means the environment that was developed by humans, like buildings, roads, a room, an AC room. Even it's an example of artificial environment. But the socio-cultural environment comprises the prevalent social practices in that society. So that comprises socio-cultural environment. Environment as a system includes physical, geographical, biological, socio-cultural, political and economic subsystem. That is, just previously discussed, environment is whole and is continuous in nature, and it is indivisible because it comprises these much subcomponents, subsystems, that is physical, geographical. Physical means that is in terms of that can be physically verified, that are physically seen. Geographical means lands that stand distant apart. Biological means all these biotic components that discussed earlier also. Socio-cultural, social norms prevalent. Political, that is what political ideology prevails here, like democracy, aristocracy, communism, etc. Economic subsystem, that is it a closed economy? Is it an open economy, etc.? So all these constitute, in a broad sense, the term environment. And you see, all these directly or indirectly, individually or in conjunction, influence the humans are the survivor of that environment. Now, what's the relationship between environment and humans? Yes, there is a deep relationship between the two. Because humans ultimately belong to environment, life is not possible without environment. Humans survive in environment, so a belongingness on the part of humans is there with respect to environment. Humans grow up in environment, yes. When they survive, definitely they grow up as a measure of life. So the concept of growth operates in environment. Without environment, there is no growth. Or speaking in other words, if there is no growth, then we must probe the environmental aspects. What's wrong there, as it's not leading to growth of the organism. Humans learn from the environment, yes. Environment must be meaningful. It should not exist as such. Things should not exist as such, but that things should exist in context with meanings. So that is, human must learn from environment. Even a natural calamity or some disaster is observed, then we learn how to overcome that, how to minimize those disasters or calamities also. So even such kind of learning may take place. Environmental studies. Now, if we focus on the term EVS, environmental study, it's a way of learning and it's a multidisciplinary in nature, that it's not a subject in itself alone, but it's a way of learning. And it comprises sciences and social sciences in broad terms. Another thing is that humans explore human interaction with the environment. So that means the domain is dynamic in nature. It does not study the humans and environment as separate entities, but explores, probes, studies them in relation to each other. How does human influence environment, and in what terms they are influenced by the environment? EVS requires teachers to provide multiple opportunities to children to interact with the environment. Yes, children are innocent by their nature. However, they are curious by nature, they are ready to learn, and they are capable of learning. So we should not leave the things to them as such, but teachers, as a facilitator of knowledge, as a co-constructor of knowledge, should facilitate them in providing the multiple opportunities so that the child may interact with the environment, and hence even environment may prove a learning source for them also. Then EVS draws the concepts from the domains of physical and biological sciences and social sciences, as said earlier. Yes. Physical sciences means physics and chemistry, biological sciences means botany, zoology, ecology, and social sciences comprise sociology, history, political sciences. So all these together in a coherent manner influence the mankind by together constituting the term as environment. Then EVS, environmental studies, aims at developing an awareness among future citizens about environmental issues. Yes. The environmental aspects, or even the term environment, should be made aware to the citizens of a society or students of a school who are going to be future citizens of that country. Because unless and until we are not aware about the term environment, how can we preserve, conserve, contribute towards its welfare? So what does the term environment mean to them should be explained as simple as possible, rather than retrieving in some formal way. Simply, environment means the things around you, your surroundings. Sometimes people pose, what's atmosphere, what's environment? The atmosphere means the surroundings around the earth. In a broad sense, that mostly comprises abiotic components. Environment comprises biotic components also. So that leads to the term environment. Environmental studies engage students in exploratory hands-on activities to acquire cognitive and psychomotor skills. Yes, EVS as such, as a way of learning, is dynamic. It's not static in nature, and it comprises certain activities which can be worked out by the children themselves by means of harnessing their latent urge, that is curiosity. And they may be motivated to explore the environment, and hence over a period of time they acquire cognitive and psychomotor skills and undergo proper cognitive development as per Piaget's theory of cognitive development. Environmental studies comprises the activities that should be real life based. That is, they should not be textual. However, they must be contextual. Things should exist in context for students. So text is not so important. Context is important, so that is real life based, because nowadays we are in the grip of nuclear weapons, pollution, population, explosion, hazards, wars, etc. So it's better to cite the things with real life examples, because it at least poses a situation in which children develop interest and the things become enjoyable for them. And over a period of time, they develop a concern for that also. Otherwise, all the things exist on text only. Then activities should be safer for students. The child is an innocent one, younger one. So don't expect a child to perform something unusual, something beyond his or her capabilities. If we remember the different stages of Piaget's also, the activities should be designed with respect to that characteristics of that stage of the child also. Then activities should be economic with respect to time. It should not be too much time consuming, because if it is too much time consuming, then children may deviate. Their interest may come to lower level. So it should not be so much time consuming. So within a reasonable time, the observation should be made available to the child, or child should be able to deduce something useful. Then EVS activities should be age appropriate. Again, in the sense that an activity that is useful for formal operational stage of Piaget's cognitive development should not be suggested for a child belonging to concrete operational or pre-operational stage, and vice versa. So it should suit to the age of the child also. Then all the activities should focus on child's experiences. Yes, what experience they will derive, how experience they will derive, and second, previous experiences of the children should be incorporated in devising the new activities so that a sense of meaningfulness persists there. Then, and above all, EVS activities should pertain to all students. For example, a definite amount of interest should also be there that suits all. Sometimes children from this much background, this much socio-cultural status, etc., don't find any interest in activities designed for the whole class, because they said that doesn't belong to them. For example, a child residing in rural area may not develop interest in exploring the factories, instruments, etc., that may lead to pollution also. Reverse is also true for a child residing in urban area may not develop proper interest for agriculture and related aspects. So it's a job of the teacher to bring the true extremes together by developing a degree of cohesion between them by citing relevant examples, relevant citations. EVS should comprise a teaching learning situation that focus on attitudes and values with respect to knowledge and information. Teaching learning of EVS must focus on attitudes and values with respect to knowledge and information. That is, if there is information, can it be processed to lead to knowledge? If there is knowledge, then is it a valid net knowledge that was constructed, or can it be practiced over the period of time so that a wisdom is developed? So EVS should focus on all these aspects. Environmental studies should incorporate those teaching methods that allow children to work together. That is, cooperative learning. Cooperative spirit is developed among the learners, because ultimately man is a social animal. So to contribute towards the welfare by adjusting into the society, it should begin since very early. That's the classroom. And even that in classroom, primary stage is the best one. And EVS, not being a discipline but a way of learning, is the one of the most powerful domain that can cater to this. EVS must examine multiple viewpoints. Yes, there should not be definite closed-ended responses or answers to anything. Multiple views should be incorporated, discussed, brought into a common platform, so that a common consensus is developed. Teaching methods must allow the children to link concepts with real life, that is, things exist in conjunction with others, that the things don't exist in isolation. Things don't exist in vacuum. Things exist for others also. Only then a meaningfulness is developed. Teaching method must motivate the children in taking positive action. Otherwise, it becomes only a bundle of information which they carry, they confess, and they go ahead without any contribution. But they must be motivated in taking positive action so that a proper, healthy environment is developed over a period of time through the efforts by the child that lead to preservation and conservation of the environment. Then, environmental study. For a problem or an issue, as a tool, it must promote introspection. It is better to discuss what's a problem and what's an issue. Problem means anything that disturbs an individual and problems are solved. Issue means that are addressed. They exist as such. So what's there? A problem or an issue? Whatever it is, then EVS as a tool must promote introspection for that. Is it able to do so? Only then it's a true way of learning, otherwise not. So the first requirement is, can it develop a degree of introspection among learners? Reflection is another domain where the children need to reflect what's going on. After that, discussion. They should undergo discussion. Otherwise, reflection at their own ends will not survive. So degree of discussion, democratic discussion must prevail there. That is, only I am right, you are wrong should not be followed. We should assert, we should accept, we should reject. Then we should arrive at a common consensus. Such kind of atmosphere, classroom learning environment must prevail there. Decision. After introspection, reflection, discussion, is the class or the group of the student or even a student is able to arrive some decision. Only then that EVS as a tool is successful. Otherwise, it may lead to different aspects. Even it may lead to confusion on the part of learner also. So all these four aspects should be practiced with great care. Then after that, environmental studies, by being a way of learning, must enable the students in understanding their role with respect to their environment. First of all, they must realize that they're a part of environment. Environment doesn't exist in exclusion to them. They are for environment, environment is for them. So we summarize whatever we have done so far. Environmental study is a way of learning. It comprises, and the environment has been derived from the French word environner, that means our surroundings. Environment may be natural, artificial, socio-cultural, and EVS as a dynamic way of learning must enable the children to introspect, reflect, discuss, and arrive at a decision so that they are able, as a responsible citizen, able to contribute towards the preservation and conservation of the environment. Thank you very much.